I've known pleasure and I've known pain. I've been places I dare not see again. I've seen faces of truth and love and deceit. So walk with me into the land of truth. Walk with me where God's freedom soothes. All life's pain, yet the question of faith remains. One small step and the beast grows tame. One small step and the darkness fades. One small step and we all find joy again. In moments of truth, we find freedom again. In moments of truth is where God breaks through. Telling truth and not hiding our lies and our pain. So walk with me to the land of truth. Walk with me where God's freedom soothes. All life's pain, yet the question of faith remains. One small step and the beast grows tame. One small step and the darkness fades. One small step and we all find joy again. One small step and the beast grows tame. One small step and the darkness fades. One small step and we all find joy again.
Good morning.
Good morning.
And happy Halloween.
Happy Halloween.
The rain stopped, so hopefully it'll be a good night for trick-or-treating. We come to worship this morning and we gather in this space surrounded by God's loving presence. We also are joined by those who watch via the live stream, and may you know that God's loving presence surrounds you as you join us in worship. And so as we come to this time of worship this morning, I would invite us to turn our hearts, our minds, and our spirits now to the worship of God.
Once there was a man who said such wonderful things and did such amazing things that people asked him who he was. And he answered them, "I am the light of the world." The light of Christ surrounds us wherever we are and at whatever time of day. But as we begin our worship this morning, it's a helpful reminder that the light of the world is present in these candles, is present in this room, and is present in each of us. Let us worship God.
Please join me in the call to worship. Hear, O people of God, our God is one. Hear the commandments of our God. First, love your God with all your heart, and with all your soul, and with all your mind, and with all your strength. Hear, O people of God, our God is one. Recite the commandments to your children and hold them in your hearts. Second, love your neighbor as yourself. There is no commandment greater than these. All love. Amen.
With one voice the angels sing songs that make creation ring. Prophets hear and call us to live in spirit and in truth. God the Father and voice of thunder, spirit wind. Breathe on me, O very life. Grace will make the darkness bright. Word of God enthroned, dwell in us forevermore. Love has come to show.
Gracious God, we confess that we have not loved you with our heart, our soul, our strength, our mind. We have not loved our neighbors with a deep and abiding compassion, and we have not loved ourselves and cared for our own truest needs. Transform our shallowness, enliven our deadness, heal our wounded, broken places, and so fill us with your spirit that we can be forgiven, even as we forgive ourselves and others. For we pray in the name of Jesus Christ, who brings us love that has no end. Amen.
Siblings in Christ, this is the good news. The God we know in Jesus Christ is a God of mercy and love. When we are disillusioned, God still accepts us as we are and continually moves toward us with forgiveness and comfort. We are freed by God's love to live in the freshness of each new day. We are freed to reach out to one another in a community of sympathy and joy. For these gifts of love, let us rejoice.
Our first scripture this morning is taken from the book of Deuteronomy, the sixth chapter, beginning with the first verse. These are the commands, decrees, and the laws your Lord, your God, has directed me to teach you to observe in the land that you are crossing into the Jordan to possess, so that you, your children, and their children after them, may fear the Lord your God as long as they may live, by keeping all God's decrees and commands that I give you, and so that you may enjoy long life. Hear, O Israel, and be careful to obey, so that it may go well with you, and that you may increase greatly in a land flowing with milk and honey, just as the Lord, the God of your fathers, promised you. Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God is one. Love the Lord your God with all your heart, and with all your soul, and with all your strength. These commandments that I give you today are to be upon your hearts. Impress them on your children. Talk about them when you sit at home and when you walk along the road, when you lie down and when you get up. Tie them as symbols on your hands and bind them on your foreheads. Write them on the door frames of your houses and your gates. This is the word of God for us, the people of God.
At this time, we are invited to join together in a covenanting. A covenant is a promise. A covenant is making promises and a reminder of our connection, both with one another, but also with God, particularly as we walk about in ministry serving Jesus Christ, our Lord. So we come today to covenant with our Minister of Faith Formation. Our new Minister of Faith Formation, Dr. Elizabeth Windsor, stands before you as the person whom we entrust this ministry on behalf of our church family. As Elizabeth builds trusted relationships with our congregation, we are reminded that this is an opportunity for all of us to learn, to grow in faith, and to serve together. As Elizabeth ministers in God's service, it is our responsibility to support her with our encouragement, our cooperation, and our prayers. Dear friends, Bethany Church has declared that, having gathered under the guidance of the Holy Spirit, it has called Dr. Elizabeth Windsor to serve in this place as our Minister of Faith Formation, and that it now receives her as appointed by God for this ministry. Elizabeth, are you willing to enter this covenant with Bethany Church?
I am willing, and I promise to serve this church faithfully, teaching the Word of God according to the faith and order of the United Church of Christ.
And people of Bethany Church, I invite you to rise in body or spirit now and affirm your covenant with our Minister of Faith Formation. We, the people of Bethany Church,
receive you as our minister of faith formation, promising to labor with you in the ministry of the gospel and to give you our prayers and support. You may be seated. A charge now to you, Elizabeth. May the Holy Spirit guide you and strengthen you, that in this faith community, you may do God's will in the service of Christ. On behalf of the congregation, we commend you to this work and promise our prayers, encouragement, nurture, and support.
Amen.
And let us all be in prayer. Great and gracious God, be with Elizabeth now, who has now affirmed her commitment to follow Christ and to serve in his name. Give her openness, patience, and vision. And I'm going to invite us, before we continue in that, just to reach out our arms in blessing towards Elizabeth as we conclude our prayer. So let's reach out our hand and arm in an act of blessing. And let us say this together. Strengthen us all as we follow Christ's example and way of love and service to others.
We pray this in your glory. Amen.
Thank you. One of the things I like best about being a Christian is that we are a blessing people. I will bless anything. When we bless, we acknowledge that God has given us a gift. And when we bless one another, we remind one another that we are God's gift to each other and that God is present in the relationship between the one who blesses and the one who is blessed. There are lots of ways to bless. We just did one of them, holding out hands. The church blesses in a number of ways when we baptize a baby. Oftentimes the sign of the cross is made on the baby's forehead. We bless the gifts at the table before we receive them. But we tend to think that blessings are something you have to be an official church person to do. And that isn't true at all. We can bless one another at any time and for any reason. I want to tell you a short story. When my now 31-year-old son was 8, he had terrible, terrible nightmares. And one of the ways in which we talked about and dealt with the nightmares was through blessings. And each night, as he went to bed, as I tucked him in, I made the sign of the cross on his forehead, and I said, "May the Lord preserve, protect, and defend you." And this went on for quite a while. But in the middle of it, I was in a fairly serious car accident. And when I got home from the hospital, my mom and dad were there to take care of my kids and to take care of me. I heard, was sort of in a half sleep, and I heard my son come in. And he put his favorite snuggly toy next to me in the bed. And then he made the cross on my forehead. And he said, "Mama, may the Lord preserve, protect, and defend you." That is the gift of blessing. And we are invited to do that at any point in the day. As you get ready to leave one another, to head out to school and to work, say a blessing over one another. May the Lord preserve and protect you until we gather together again. Whatever words feel comfortable to you, and whatever gestures feel comfortable to you. You might want to lay hands on shoulders. You might want to make the sign of the cross. You might want to hold hands. There are lots of different ways we can bless one another. So please think about incorporating daily blessing into your lives. I promise you, it is a gift that will continue long after the actual blessing itself. Amen.
Our second reading this morning comes to us from the Gospel according to Mark, and I read from chapter 12, beginning in verse 28. One of the scribes came near and heard them disputing with one another, and seeing that he answered them well, he asked him, "Which commandment is the first of all?" Jesus answered, "The first is, 'Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. And you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, and with all your soul, and with all your mind, and with all your strength. The second is this: you shall love your neighbor as yourself. There is no other commandment greater than these.' Then the scribe said to him, 'You are right, teacher. You have truly said that he is one, and beside him there is no other. And to love him with all your heart, and with all the understanding, and with all the strength, and to love one's neighbor as oneself. This is much more important than all the whole burnt offerings and sacrifices. When Jesus saw that he answered wisely, he said to him, "You are not far off from the kingdom of God." After that, no one dared to ask him any question. For the word of God in Scripture, for the word of God among us, for the word of God within us, thanks be to God. Will you pray with me? O God of love and life, as we come to worship you this day and celebrate your presence in our lives, in the many ways in which you show yourself to us, we are grateful for your word, which comes into us by your Spirit. Ancient words and new words that comfort and encourage, that guide and teach, that challenge and inspire. And now, O God, I pray that the words of my mouth and the meditations of each of our hearts may be acceptable in your sight, for you alone are our rock, and you alone our Redeemer. And for this, we give you thanks and praise. Amen. All right, it's Halloween. Let's do a little inventory. Costumes, what are we wearing for costumes? Any costumes? Ursula. Ursula. Ooh, what's your costume? Sebastian. I remember the Little Mermaid. I love Sebastian. Makes me want to sing. Any other costumes from older children?
Elmo.
Elmo. Wonderful. Any others?
Myself.
Yourself. Very good. Very good. Okay, now down to the really important stuff. Candy. Small bars or full-size bars?
Small.
Any full-size bars? Please leave your addresses. We will be to your house today or tonight. And now, your favorite candy. Your favorite candy. Do you have a favorite? What? Three Musketeers. Favorite candy. Peanut butter cups. I'm with you. Reese's galore. Chocolate. Anything chocolate seems like a good safe bet. Oh, like a heart candy? Like sweet tarts? Yeah. Yeah, sounds good. Any other favorite candies?
Snickers.
Okay. Least favorite candy to get when you're trick-or-treating. What's your least favorite candy to get when you were trick-or-treating?
Black licorice.
Oh, lots of black licorice. And I'm with you on that one, too. That's the one thing. Least favorite candy?
Butterfingers.
Mm. Mm. Least favorite?
Almond Joys.
Fireballs. I used to love when we got together after trick-or-treating, you probably did this too, and you'd swap out, so the things you liked that somebody else didn't like, and you'd make trades for all these candy. And then if you were like me, and you saw that your sister's bag of or bowl of candy had like lots of Reese's peanut butter cups, you'd casually just move a few over to your bag because it's Reese's peanut butter cups. You get it. Your mom would do that, yeah. And of course, in order to
partake in Halloween and get the candy, whether it's the kind that we like or don't like, whether it's the kind we hand out, little bars and big bars. What's the magic words? Trick or treat. Now, I have to say, we don't quite know the origin for that whole expression, trick or treat. We kind of get the idea, of course, that it's almost like a do you want a trick, a mischievous thing done? And in order to avoid that, just give us a treat. It's kind of an interesting exchange, isn't it? It's almost like a threat. Extortion is a good word for it, too. But nevertheless, it's part of our nomenclature and common terms for this day and for this night that we want to make sure we say trick or treat. And we almost always know we end up getting some candy. But it's not an option of one or the other, like trick or treat. It's not extortion or demand when Jesus has this conversation with a scribe, someone who knows the teachings and the law of God very well. And here they are having this conversation that the scribe entered in on. Both good theologians, both knowing their scripture, and they come into this conversation. You may have heard this story before in other gospels, but here it almost seems in Mark's gospel, it's not so much that the scribe is trying to trick Jesus and to catch him and see him making a mistake in order to say he's really not a proper teacher of God's law. But rather it is to enter a conversation this scribe comes in with Jesus on. And perhaps that's a good reminder for us that that's what nurturing and forming our faith is all about. It's about having a conversation with one another, sharing our thoughts and relying upon what we've learned in the past, but also bringing in our experiences and having this conversation about who God is and what God calls us to do and who we are and how to make the world more like the kingdom of God and get closer to that. Faith formation is very much about having that conversation. And I would say we are a tradition and a people where, well, really just creating a space to ask the questions is of utmost importance. It's not a blind faith that says, just believe it, and here's how it works, and here's where you follow. But it is to open up to say why and how and what, and I wonder, and I imagine. Faith formation starts with asking questions. Faith formation happens when we continue to have a conversation. Sometimes we get to a very clear answer. Sometimes that answer is something we all agree to, and sometimes it's a little different for each one of us. But that's what it is to be a community of faith and to be on this journey to travel together and to talk with one another. And God knows it's been getting a lot more difficult, particularly in our country, to feel we can have a conversation with one another, particularly if we're of such opposing views and ideas. So this text is a reminder that for our faith and for the sake of our communities and for the sake of relationship, having conversations, even difficult ones, and learning how to navigate them is very important. Jesus says to the scribe, he offers the answer to the question, what's the first commandment? He recites that ancient expression from the book of Deuteronomy. Our Jewish siblings in faith call that the Shema. Hear, O Lord, hear, O Israel, is the Lord your God, and you shall love the Lord your God. And many of our Jewish siblings will, in fact, have that text written on a very tiny piece of paper. It will be rolled up inside of a little container that is attached to their doorway. And as Elizabeth talked about blessings, one of the things that as a faith practice they will do is they will always touch that piece from Deuteronomy, the Shema, in the container on the door as they leave the house, as a reminder of how central and important that command is, to love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your strength. Jesus, in reciting that important teaching, which he no doubt learned from his parents, who learned from theirs, who learned far back, a reminder that we pass on to each generation what we believe and what God calls us to say about how God works and who God is and how important it is to love God and how that makes such a difference. Jesus adds in a little extra piece, though. He also includes loving God with all your mind. Not that it wasn't there before, but he also seems, according to Mark's gospel, to make a point of adding that. And what does that tell us? To use what God has given us in our mind and for intelligence and for reason and for logic, to add that into the living of our faith and our understanding of God and the world. But unlike leaving the options that come with trick or treat, Jesus adds something else. And instead of or, he says and. Not only should you love God, but you should also love your neighbor as yourself. An additionally important thing. For Jesus, this flows from that first commandment of loving God. It naturally flows into and loving neighbor. I suspect more often than not, we can come up with a long list of how it is and reasons why we love God. But maybe there's that neighbor who we can come up with just as long a list as why we don't like them so much. And I'm not just talking about the one who lives next door to us, but the one who maybe is that different from us. It's a hard thing to do sometimes. And I would say that we may not always like everyone, that's human emotion, but we're called by God to move into that place of still loving everyone. A kind of love that acknowledges them as fully human, full of potential and gifts, a kind of love that sees them as a child of God, full of the same worth and value as we have. So loving neighbor as ourselves, if we see ourselves as having worth and value, then from that, we're called to make sure to see that everybody has that same worth and value, regardless of who they are or where they come from or their journey. Perhaps you've heard of this other expression, that there are only two things we can give our children. The one is roots and the other is wings. Two important characteristics and callings of parenthood, but also of communities of faith. And while God isn't mentioned in it, it's very easy to see how that expression fits in with these great commandments, the first and the second. That we are called as individual families and as a family of faith to make sure our children, those generations who come after us, have roots, that there's something they're grounded into and can feel some sense of stability and assurance, that they can always come back to their faith and a community of faith and be loved and valued and received with open arms, that they know they're safe and secure amidst all that might not make it feel that way out in the world. Amidst all the ways their paths might twist and turn, that they can come back and know that there's something that grounds them. We'll hear more later as we enter into our stewardship campaign for next year about being rooted in love. That's what we're called to do, and to teach our children, and to make sure happens, that they and we are always rooted in love, that love feeds us, love for God, and love for neighbor makes us reach out and care and share. And as far as wings go, well, that's just as important, but that's also rooted in love. That while there's a time and a place to know that we are always rooted, from there, to have something where we can go forth and travel on our own, that we can make our way. So wings do that. And what we do when we gather around God's word and these great commandments, what we do when we teach and when we share and when we ask questions, to remember the God that calls us to love and the God who grounds us and the God who promises to be with us is the one who also wants us to be our fullest selves and fly off and travel and bear witness to this God wherever we go. Wings give us the ability to fly away from preconceived notions and prejudices and be free to travel with as light a load as possible, to be on the winds of the Spirit, seeking to serve and to love God with all our heart, with all our soul, with all our mind, and to love our neighbors as ourselves. May this be our work, our ministry, in helping to form the faith of one another and those who come after us, whether it be here in this place, in homes, out on the streets, wherever there is a need, wherever there is a calling. Thanks be to God. I'm going to invite us now into a time of prayer. And first, may we lift up all those joys and concerns that are upon our hearts today and share them with God in a time of silent conversation. Oh God, we thank you for the gift of this day and for the gift of a beautiful fall season around us and for the gifts that come in the fun of trick-or-treating, of the laughs and the silliness, of the chance to dress up and be somebody else. For the chance to enjoy the simple things of neighborhoods of being with one another. And we give you thanks that you are the one who is always with us, journeying through
through all the twists and turns of life. You always love us and continue to encourage us in ways in which we can more deeply love you with our whole being. And help us to deepen our love for neighbor. We pour out our love for others by lifting up prayer concerns for those upon our prayer list and for those we silently offer to you. And as you receive those prayers, may all for whom we pray know of your loving presence, giving encouragement and comfort, giving hope and endurance, giving peace of mind and peace of soul and peace of heart. Hear our prayers, O Lord. Incline your ear to us and let us incline our ear to you, to listen for your promised word. So we humbly offer this prayer along with the silent meditations of our hearts, even as we are bold to pray, as Jesus taught, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. For our call to offering this morning, I'm going to invite Deb Byron forward, who has graciously offered to share her stewardship testimony.
Good morning.
Good morning.
I'd like to share why stewardship is important to me this morning. Stewardship time is the season of commitment and recommitment in church life. I came across a phrase the other day. It was in an advertisement for a Christian book, and the phrase was, "Our world says we need to try harder, but Jesus says, come closer." That simple sentence helped me realize why I have a strong commitment to this church. The words, the world's try harder ethos can be damaging and demoralizing, while coming closer to Jesus provides the spiritual strength to live a good and meaningful life. Bethany has provided me with many opportunities to come closer to Jesus after welcoming my family 26 years ago. Since then, I've learned much about what it means to follow Christ through worship and study and serving others. I've participated as a deacon, a Sunday school teacher, a small group leader, and countless times just as an extra pair of hands. I was a staff member for several years and so inspired by the warmth and support of this congregation. Mostly, though, I've learned what it means to follow Christ through relationships and conversations, as we've all played and worked together. Through this family of Christ, I've experienced God's love and sustaining comfort during times of illness and grief, and I've experienced inspiration and joy as we've celebrated both the major and the more mundane moments of life together. All of that said, though, it's not about me, my love for this church, or my history. It's about how together we can ensure that Bethany continues to change lives and inspire others to want to know Jesus. It's about deepening our reach into the wider community. I just love the rooted in love theme of this year's commitment season. To me, rooted means to be anchored or grounded. It means being nourished and strengthened. God's love has grounded and nourished me through the relationships and activities I've experienced here. And it's only when we're grounded and nourished in God that we're able to demonstrate her love for others. And I think that's our primary purpose as a church. As you prayerfully consider your pledge for next year, think about the fact that we're in a new and challenging season in Bethany's life. We called Pastor Chris just a short time ago, and Elizabeth an even shorter time ago. We've been through a tough few years with lots of changes, but we felt we were poised to turn the page. And then the pandemic hit. The world has been profoundly changed by the virus, and so has church. I think Bethany has done an amazing job adapting to the new normal and managing to provide us weekly worship during this time, virtually, out of doors, now back in the sanctuary, as well as live stream. I'm so grateful for the staff and volunteers who have worked so hard to bring us church these many months. Nothing will be quite the same again after we emerge from the pandemic, but for sure there will be great opportunities to show Jesus to the world. As a church community, we need to be ready, financially as well as spiritually, to embrace these. Giving is as much a spiritual exercise as it is an economic one. The author Maya Angelou said, "I have found that among its other benefits, giving liberates the soul of the giver." So let's free up our souls so that as a church, we can fully participate in God's plan for our community and the greater world. Amen.
Thank you for sharing those words, Deb. Very inspiring. So may we now come to a time where we share our offering to God.
It is the cry of my heart to follow you. It is the cry of my heart to be close to you. It is the cry of my heart to follow all of the days of my life. It is the cry of my heart to follow you. It is the cry of my heart to be close to you. It is the cry of my heart to follow all of the days of my life. Teach me your holy ways, O Lord, so I can walk in your truth. Teach me your holy ways, O Lord, and make me wholly devoted to you. It is the cry of my heart to follow you. It is the cry of my heart to be close to you. It is the cry of my heart to follow all of the days of my life. Open my eyes.
Transform our lives, O God, and let these gifts change the world into which we send them. Take them and multiply them to be a blessing of justice and peace in the world you love. Amen.
You may be seated. A few announcements before we head out into our day. All are invited to join with us after worship for a time of refreshment and fellowship down in our breezeway. And I'm going to have Libby come and give us some updates and other announcements regarding the fair.
Good morning.
Good morning.
I am Libby Carter, and I am co-chair with Diane Thies of the Harvest Fair, which is this Saturday. You can see we've been busy downstairs. Friday night, we were very blessed to have some of our youth of our church come help us out and start sorting. They brought everything in and had a good time going through all the boxes. Downstairs, you'll see that the scavenger hunt has been started. You can take a look at the categories. And if you'd like to come help us during the week, come open those boxes, see what you find. You might find something that belongs in one of those categories, and you might win the prize. I think the youth had a good time. I was pleased to see so many there. Some other announcements is we definitely need a lot more help. So I'm here begging, pleading, asking, inviting. Please sign up to help on the day of the fair. There's a sign-up bulletin board downstairs, or you can sign up online on the sign-up genius. The other thing I need help with is to spread the word. Just let people know that we're having a fair. It's new for the community. It's a new time for the community. And not everybody is aware of what's going on. We've tried to do some advertising, but word of mouth is probably the best way to get the word out there. I also want to invite you to bring canned goods in on that day. The Boy Scouts will be here collecting food for the food pantry. And it's our way of welcoming them to our new community. So if anybody has any questions, feel free to find me downstairs. Thank you.
Thank you, Libby. And just to dovetail with that, Wendy made up some copies of the flyers for the fair, and they're actually out in the narthex. So if there's places you know around town that you can post one or think is a good idea, feel free to take one or two or a few with you. And as mentioned, as you see things this week, if you're on our Facebook page, don't just like them, but hit that little share button, and then the word will also get around. We do continue to receive donations for the food pantry and some things they're in particular need of. The list is in your insert. And next Sunday, we will celebrate All Saints Sunday, so you are welcome to share names with the office of those who have passed since the last All Saints Sunday in your lives that you would like included in our reading of names. You're also encouraged and invited to bring a picture of loved ones who have passed, as we will have a table with candles and a chance to light candles in memory of those who've gone before us. So feel free to bring those to add to that tablescape. And once again, we're looking for some more volunteers up in our tech booth as we continue our vital and necessary ministry for having our service be live streamed out into the community and the world. And if you have questions or you want to just explore or hang out up with the tech booth with Kirsten, she'd love to have you up there to visit. So with those announcements made, I would invite us to rise in body or spirit as we come to our time of commissioning and benediction.
We spoke about the light at the beginning of the service, and that light goes with us into the world. We are not extinguishing the candles. The light has changed, and it is filling this space, and it is filling us. Breathe it in deeply, and
take that light out into the world with you.
Siblings in Christ, may we go out into the world in peace, being strong and of good courage, lifting the faint of heart and supporting the weak, holding fast to that which is good, resisting that which is evil, giving thanks in all circumstances, praying constantly, knowing most of all that the God who we worship here today is the God who goes with us through these doors and out into our week ahead. And may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, the fellowship of the Holy Spirit rest and remain with each one of us now and forevermore. And let God's people say, Amen. And following the passing of the peace, you're invited to remain for some very appropriately spooky music to get us ready for tonight. May the peace of Christ be with you.
And also with you.
Let us share signs and words of peace with those around us.